Hi everyone, I wanted to give some of the highlights that I had from my Bible immersion this morning. Let me pray. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I thank you for the way that your word speaks to my heart. I pray that the things that I gleaned from your word today, I can speak it in a way that it helps another person. Helps them to know you and to love you and by seeing the love that you have for them. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Hi. Today in my Bible immersion, the word in the Old Testament was Exodus 23 through 25. In the New Testament, it was Matthew 19. 16 through 30. For this slide presentation, I wanted to just focus on Matthew 19, 16 through 22. Some people call this the rich young ruler, the story of the rich young ruler. As a summary, I wanted to say that the story is a young man approaches Jesus with a question. He wants to hear from Jesus his take on what was needed for eternal life. We do this sometimes. We know the answer almost, or we have heard the answer, but we're hoping that it's something different, that it won't be so drastic in terms of what we know about eternal life. But Jesus, in reply to the young man's query, told him that he must keep the commandments of God. There are many in this world that don't know the commandments of God because they're not in the Word. And then there are other people who don't want to know the commands of the Lord, so they don't stay in the Word. The young man then asked Jesus to be specific. So Jesus listed those commandments he meant. And the young man proudly stated that he had done them all. And like an afterthought asked, "Is there anything else I need?" Jesus is such a loving and a patient teacher. In another gospel, it says about him and his thoughts about the young man is that he loves the young man, and he loves us. We can be quite proud and immature, but he still loves us nonetheless. Then Jesus said to the young man that if that young man wanted to be complete, he should sell all he had, give his money to the poor, and then follow him. My thoughts were about the story of Abraham and Isaac. You know, God always wants us to know that we have Isaacs and to have a truly mature relationship with him. We have to be willing to lay our Isaacs on the altar, as Abraham did. It takes a lot to do that. And thank God that he's so patient. And thank God he gives us his Holy Spirit, who helps us. The Holy Spirit takes our hands, a lot like what happened when Lot was told to leave Sodom. He just couldn't do it. But God's angels helped him and his family get out of that city. The young man, when he heard what Jesus said, he went away sadly, because the Bible tells us that he was very rich. So there were about three or four verses that really touched my heart. I wanted to talk about them tonight. The first verse was Matthew 19:16, and it read, "And behold, a young man came up to him, saying, 'Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? Matthew 19:16. And I highlighted, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? You know, for many years, I definitely was like that rich young man. I thought that in order to make it with God, that I had to do something, that it was all dependent on what I did and not on what he did. So for many years, I kind of felt that I was doing quite well. I thought it was my good works that gave me a standing with God. But when I was honest, I hardly thought much about God except when I needed him to get me out of some tough spot. But thank the Lord, because at the age of 41, and like I keep saying when I make these recordings, I'm 71 right now, almost 72. But at the age of 41, I became saved. I finally understood the nature of my sin nature and the need to surrender to the Lord. He was the only one that could take away my sin by the blood of his own son, Jesus Christ. It's like that song that they sing. Who can take away my sins, or what can take away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And I have been truly saved. And so God can never be an afterthought with me. I want him to be king over each breath that I take, because I know no greater life than what I am living. I want to stay as close as I can to him. And so my prayer is, dear Father, the life I had before seems so far away. I thank you so very, very much for my rescue. You love the world, and you want no one to perish. Please strengthen me to work for you today with all my heart. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. The next verse was 19:17, and it read, "And he said to him," the young man said to Jesus, I'm sorry, Jesus said to the young man, "Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments." Matthew 19:17. And the part that stood out to me was the phrase, "keep the commandments." You know, God has taken the time to show me the specific things that make for a good life. He has provided the Spirit's power that gives me the strength to get it done. And even when my attitude is less than stellar, he even gives me the willingness to change when I asked him. But I would not know these things if I were not in the Bible. Moreover, I would not effectively apply these things if I didn't stay in the Word. You know, for me, it's not just a matter of knowing the Word. I have to remember it as well, especially when the devil is beating down the door. In my prayer, dear Father, you have made being in your Word each day a delight. I'm grateful he's done that for me. And I see how it's growing me up. And please keep me listening to your Word, reading and studying and memorizing your Word, praying your Word each day. Your Word fills me with good things and equips me to make an eternal difference in the lives of the people around me. Thank you for this eternal life in Christ Jesus. I pray to keep spreading the good news through the testimony of my life. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. The next verse I had was Matthew 19:18, and it read, "He said to him," Which ones? That's the rich young ruler speaking to Jesus. Which one? And Jesus said, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. The phrase that rang out to me today, bear false witness. You know, twice today that has come up in my reading. It was in the Exodus reading, but it's also here in Matthew. My mind thinks, when I think of bearing false witness, I think about lying, which I'm sure it means that too. But today I was thinking of the times when I am not living as the daughter of the King that I am. You know, I have witnessed the goodness of the Lord all over my life. And to act as if I hadn't would be false. That's false witnessing for me. Dear Father, all who I encounter should know that I belong to you. When I fan up doubt in the things I say and in the way that I act, then I am being a false witness. I am yours, and I desire to live a life of truth. I pray to point others to you through all that I think, say, and do. Please convict me when I am missing the mark. I pray to run back to you when I am corrected. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. And the last one that I had today was Matthew 19:19, and it read, honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The phrase, your father and mother. Although we might not know who our father is, or even some people, their mother, they were adopted. We all had a father and a mother. And in my growing up, there was a time in my life when I was quite critical of my parents, and particularly in one parent, I was quite, I could even be disrespectful. But I have to tell you, the Lord has taught me so much being a parent now myself, and I have learned to zip my lips when it comes to criticizing my parents or criticizing anyone when I'm in my right mind. Because this is the prayer. Dear Father, you were the one that handpicked my parents. Thank you for all that they gave to me. I am sorry for the times when my mouth sinned against them because of their imperfections and weaknesses. Please, Lord, grow me up to have an attitude of gratitude and not that of a spoiled brat because of the shortcomings of human beings. And I want to stop there. You know, all human beings have shortcomings. All of us do. And a better use of my time is to pray for those shortcomings and not to sit around and keep going over and over and over again about the shortcomings of other people. When I do that, it shows my own immaturity, and it shows that I'm allowing myself to be used by that evil one. God wants me not to be overcome by evil, but to overcome evil with good. And so I pray that's true for you too tonight. But let me pray. Father, thank you so much again for being so loving and so lovely. I pray that someone has been helped by something that I have said. I don't want to hurt anyone. In the name of Jesus Christ, Father, I pray. Amen. Amen, you guys. Have a wonderful night. God bless you. Bye-bye.